Hello everybody! Today BION is visiting Kamiel Hamers, one of the most famous breeders of lizards from Uromastyx group. So now we are in the Netherlands, in his sanctuary, I hope. Yeah, and here you can see a lot of species behind us. The two species are settled in the in another room. So behind us we can see Saara loricata. We will show it to you later. And today we have a unique opportunity to ask Kamiel a lot of questions. First of all, Kamiel, say hello to our subscribers.
Hi guys.
Hello to a lot of people who maybe know you personally or who wants to know you personally. So my first question is, for how long are you involved in herpetoculture, and who inspired you, and why did you choose this field? So why did you choose herpetoculture as your hobby?
Well, first of all, welcome to the Netherlands. Welcome to my little dream palace.
Thanks.
It started all when I was about 12 years old. There was a guy in our local library, and he had a pet snake, and he showed us kids. I was a small kid, and he showed us around, and we could handle it. And since that day, every day I want a snake, or I want a lizard, or. But my mom and dad said no, you're too young and you're irresponsible and we don't know anything about it. And so you get it when you're 18 and you're responsible, you're a responsible guy and you can take care of it by yourself, because we don't know anything about it. And first I thought, man, oh man, that's harsh. I want it now. But looking back, I think it was a perfect decision, because they didn't know anything about it. And I was way too young, 12 years old, to care for it by myself back then. And I started to read up on snakes and lizards, and eventually when I turned about 18, I got my first pet gecko, a leopard gecko. It was a Herpetoculture macularis.
Yeah.
It was already an adult male, and I made a lot of mistakes with that first lizard, and I learned a lot from that gecko. And it unfortunately died, I think about 2 years ago, and I had it for 21 years, I think, 22 years back then. So, and it was probably already 3 years old when I got it, so it was pretty decent age. But that's how I started. And some of the people that really inspired me were someone like Henk Zwarteporte. He was a curator of the zoo in Rotterdam, and he was someone that would talk to you, and he was already older than me, but he was still learning. He always said, I'm always learning, and he was willing to listen, but he was willing to listen also to other people, and that was really cool about him. He taught me a lot, he taught me a lot of things, and that was really nice. Other people that inspired me were like Thomas Wilms.
Yeah,
because I love this book about the Uromastyx. That's probably one of the reasons I really love those Uromastyx. Beautiful pictures in there, and well, a really good description of how they live in the wild. And that's why I really love the to get into the Uromastyx more.
What is your job?
My job
is
taking care of my kids. So
I
stopped working about 3 years ago, I think, because my wife got a great opportunity for her work, and she needed me to stop working. So I had the opportunity to stop working.
I also want to be like this.
And that's when the hobby doubled.
How many species do you breed and do you keep now, and how many animals do you have in total?
I think I got about, from the Uromastyx, I got 12 species, I think, of Uromastyx, and I bred 9 of them. Mm-hmm. That's Uromastyx and loricata, and Saara, because I got loricata.
And everybody knows them as loricata.
And I got a few other species. Altogether, I think I have about 75 animals, and that's adult animals. I got a few babies, but
Yeah, but most of them are already sold.
Yeah, so yeah. That's no
Let's
keepers.
Not count them.
No.
Okay, and what is your favorite species? Well, I know the answer. The answer is sitting here.
Yes, loricata is my favorite species now. Yeah, for the last since 2010, I got them as this big.
Yeah,
and those are my favorite species. Well, I also really love the ornates. I think Uromastyx ornata are probably the best Uromastyx for captivity because they're regularly bred in captivity. Mm-hmm. So you can get a captive bred animal, which is always way better than a wild caught. There's a lot of knowledge on them because there's more breeders breeding those, and they get such beautiful different colorations. You got blue ones, you got green ones, you got a bit more red in it. I really love those colorful ones.
I think a lot of our subscribers agree with you. Which species is your dream to work with in the future?
I think I've got pretty much my dream collection right now. There is, if space wasn't an issue, I would really like to work with Ciclura and then maybe the Figus Eye or something like that.
What?
But well, space is an issue.
Yeah, for Ciclura fish.
I only have this much space, and Ciclura need nice big cages.
Let's build your normal garage.
Yeah, that's don't let the wife hear that, but that's an opportunity. Maybe in the future, I don't know. But for now, I'm pretty happy with what I got, and I hope to maintain this collection. Mm-hmm. And I hope to be breeding a lot of Uromastyx in the future too.
We hope so. Okay, and what is the key to successful breeding from Kamiel Hamers? What is the key point?
Patience. Patience is key. That's what I always tell people. A lot of people think if I buy a pair, I can breed them. But it's probably even better to just buy a group of babies from different breeders and then raise them up yourself so you know what you got. You know what's gone into the animals. You know they're strong, good animals. And just wait a few more years. Mm-hmm. Wait until they're breeding age 3 to 5 years old. And then you know you got good breeder animals. And after about 2 years, you start cycling them together. So they have a same cycle. The females produce their eggs at the same time that the males are getting horny. Mm-hmm. So when they mate, that will result in a good eggs.
Yeah.
I think it's better just to see it in the long run than just buy adults and hope for the best. And that's what I always tell people. Patience. Patience. They don't breed this year. Well, then make sure they thrive this year. They do your best to keep them at their best and they will breed next year.
Who are your main colleagues and partners in herpetoculture?
Well, my main partner is, of course, my wife. And with Herpetoculture, I got a few good friends in the Netherlands. One of them is Cliff Blatt. Mm-hmm. And we go way back together. He used to keep a lot of mothers, and I was a Uromastyx guy. And now he's also keeping a lot of Uromastyx. And we help each other out with vacations and holidays and other stuff, hatching eggs or that kind of stuff. We help each other. And that's really cool to have someone pretty close to me. Other friends are actually probably my best buddies in the reptile world are Tom Grapp and Robert Bloom from the United States. Those guys, they had so much knowledge. When I met them about 12 years ago maybe, I met them and they had so much more knowledge than I had, and they helped me a lot with everything.
Concerning these cages, do you make them by yourself, or they are commercial, or it's a mix of both approaches?
Well, yeah, it's a mix of both. But in the other room, you've seen, those cages are from wooden cages, and those I made myself. Mm-hmm. And this room is all from pro cages. Mm-hmm. And that's because I didn't want to spend the time building those cages again. And because I really love them, because they're white, and the desert species really love a lot of light. So if you got light cages, it looks better for them.
Yeah.
Well, I really love those probe cages. They're doing good for me.
Cool. Okay, and what types of lamps do you prefer to use for your mastic species and other species?
Yeah, I use a few different kinds. I don't have a brand that I really love. For the UVB, I use a lot of those HQI lights, mm-hmm. Externally ballasted lights, mm-hmm. and I try to the best cages I got have two of them next to each other combined, so you got a big area of UVB, mm-hmm. But that's expensive, it costs a lot of money, lights are expensive, so I'm still working on making that happen. So some have only one, or some don't need additional heat because it's pretty warm in this room already.
Okay, how often do you use a vet service and do you treat your animals by yourself?
I go to the vet when something's wrong or when I get new animals, mm-hmm. I see a vet. I don't really treat animals myself. I can treat them myself, but I always visit the vet, mm-hmm. to know what I have to do. Because I'm not a vet, I don't know my disease as well. So if he tells me, I can put a needle in them, or I can force feed them, or I can give them oral medicine. Mm-hmm. But I always visit the vet to know, mm-hmm. what kind of stuff I need to
do. It's a very wise approach, of course. Do you keep your some of your species outdoors? If yes, then which species and how long?
I keep actually only two species outdoors, mm-hmm. and that's the smaug, gigantes, mm-hmm. You've seen, and the Hermann's tortoises, Testuda hermanni hermanni from France, mm-hmm. and I keep those two. I keep those outside from start of April, mm-hmm. until the end of October. I just, mm-hmm. got them in. And they do really great outside. Mm-hmm. They love the Dutch weather, especially because it's getting a little warmer here than, mm-hmm. it was about 15 years ago. Yeah. And they do great outside. For the Uromastyx, we have in summer, we have a few weeks, I could, or days sometimes, I could put them outside, and I have made outdoor cages for a few of them, but it tend to stress them a lot. To move them outside, the moving is stressing, and also the birds that fly over, they stress them a lot. So for most of them, it's not worth it. The good the sun does is always the stress is a lot worse than the sun does good.
What problems you anticipate in herpetoculture today? What problems?
Well, there's a lot of problems.
Of course.
There's a few big problems.
Name three main of them.
There's a few big problems because of it's getting more popular. Mm-hmm. You also will see there's a lot more mistakes being made, and the problem is people don't really know about exotic animals, and they look strange to exotic keepers. Mm-hmm. Sometimes even criminalize us. How can you keep a snake? That's it's dangerous, and they don't know anything about it. If a snake escapes, a harmless little ball python, it will be in the news.
Of course.
And if a dog bites someone, that someone probably should die before it's in the news.
Yeah.
So it's I got some mixed feelings. Of course, it's more. There's more mistakes being made because of more people getting into the hobby. But I also hope that the hobby will be viewed better too. So we got a lot of people keeping exotics do a lot of homework before they get an exotic animal. But there's a lot of things going wrong in keeping birds, keeping dogs, cats.
Yeah.
But they don't care. Or something, I think.
Yeah.
And that's my biggest problem with people saying, "Ah, you can't keep them. It's a wild animal. You should leave them in the wild."
Okay. Do you think that private breeders like you, like a lot of people all over the world, can participate in protection of endangered species? Because for most of people, keeping a lizard, keeping an exotic animal, is just for fun.
I think private breeders can help a lot. I would encourage it when private breeders and zoos would work together more, because I think you can both gain. The breeder can gain knowledge, and same for the zoos. They should work together way more, I think. So I think there's a big step to make still. And for some species, there's already, I think in Germany, there's already a group of private people that works...
Are you talking about Uwe Seidel, who saved the salamander in Israel?
Yeah, things like that. And so I think there's still... but for the first thing, I think it's good just to get a good, healthy, captive population of the animals we got. And that means not too much inbreeding, but it also means don't try to breed for colors.
Yeah. Do you like traveling?
I love traveling.
Yeah, so which countries have you been to, and which countries do you want to visit?
There's a lot of...
Ukraine!
I want to visit Ukraine really, really a lot. The first thing is I... visited Costa Rica about 10 years ago, I think now, and that's really one of the best places if you love lizards. It's just loaded with lizards and snakes, and it's really beautiful.
A lot
of nature. If you ever want to go, that's the place to go. And now I go to Arizona every year to visit my friends I talked about, and I do that since 2009. I've been there about every year, and it's... First of all, it was because I wanted to see the chuckwallas in the wild. The first year it was all about that, and then I got to know those guys, and now it's about meeting friends over there and going out together, talking about reptiles, dreaming about reptiles, and catching reptiles and releasing reptiles. And it's they were really good friends now.
Can you suppose that your kids share your hobby?
I got two boys. And they like the lizards. They especially like it when the babies hatch from the from the eggs, because that's just cool. So when I got eggs and I know when they about to hatch, they will look every morning if something hatched already. And sometimes they help me with feeding or cleaning, but I don't think they will. Well, maybe they will. They're still young, but it could be. But I'm not disappointed if they don't.
So, and our last question is, have you heard about responsible herpetoculture project from BION in Ukraine?
I did hear. I talked with Dmitry about it in that last ham show, I think.
Yeah.
So I did hear about it a little, and I think it's a really, really good.
Yeah. So I think that it is really important for not just to keep animals, breed them, and make total mess so all over the world with the leagues. So it's the new approach that will help us, I think, not to be happy with our hobby, but also to make some benefit for wild nature, for animals. And may also take an opportunity to invite you to our Responsible Herpetoculture International Conference in Kyiv in September 2020.
That would be nice.
Okay, and this is a small present for you.
Thank you.
This is a BION t-shirt.
That's pretty cool, thanks.
Yeah, so thank you very much for your interview. It was a really big pleasure to be here, and I hope that you also enjoyed the interview. I think that we will meet with Kamiel a lot of times in the future, and we will make a lot of interesting, a lot of informative, and a lot of very cool videos with him and his reptiles. Have fun, guys, do responsible herpetoculture, and teach your kids how to behave with lizards. Goodbye, have fun.
Thanks, bye.
Bye.